Just finished playing the full campaign of 1812, Napoleon's fateful march. And not to spoil what happened here in this after-action report, but the box cover basically captures the final state of things. So here we are. If you haven't seen this game, this is new from VUCA Simulations. It is a fantastic production. It is about the 1812 campaign into Russia. You've got one player playing the Russians, and you've got another player down here playing the French. And essentially, the way the game starts is you've got a massive French army here in the eastern reaches of Prussia and Poland, and they're essentially obviously going to be wanting to push east through Russia, which you can see here. It's a point-to-point game, eventually, hopefully, taking Moscow. This game, I will come out and say at the beginning, I think is going to be one of the top games of the year, at least for me. I think it is a brilliantly designed game. It is so full of challenge and puzzle and tough decisions and careful management of resources and bluffing. It's just a fantastic production. And Brian Askelov, the designer, hats off on this. I think it's one of those games where you play it and everything just sings. So I was playing the Russians in this game, and here you can see the screen. So every army, every general has their own screen, and the forces are going to be concealed behind it. So in some sense, it's very much like a block game, although it does use counters. There are different unit types, and the production value on these is really nice. These portraits are fantastic. You can see the French ones here on this side. See if I can get an angle for you. There's Eugene, and there's Napoleon himself. Each of those is going to correspond to one of these standees on the map, and the way the game is played is the game is really all about logistics. We had very few battles in this game, although the battles we did have were very critical, and in that way it reminds me a lot of Levian Campaign. But the way that the turn works is you have a deck of cards, so it is a bit of a CDG, and the cards have some information on them. So they've got when they've got an ops value, well, not an ops value, it's an orders value, and they've got events. They've also got when you can use them. So this is a battle card, for example. And then sometimes these cards are playable only in certain seasons. So these are only playable in winter. Here's one that's playable at any time. Here's some summer ones. Each side has their own deck. The cards are a lot of the historical flavor and significant events come out through the cards. And the game is played over the course of 5 months. You start at the very end of June with the invasion, and you play through potentially till the end of November if you're playing the campaign. There is a start that's just the beginning of the invasion scenario. There's a scenario that starts with Smolensk onward, and there's also a scenario that starts with Napoleon's retreat from Moscow. We actually called the game here at the beginning of November, and I'll tell you why that is and who won. So you're going to start by playing a card from your hand. And when you play a card, usually you're going to be playing it for the orders value, and that orders value is going to give you some number of orders, and that's what's on these blocks. And there's a whole bunch of different orders. And each side, it's kind of asymmetric, so each side's order pool is slightly different. But there's a bunch of different ones. You've got some fake dummy orders you can put out to bluff. Things like rallying troops, you can force march troops, you can evade battle, you can place depots, very important. You can defend if you think you're going to be attacked. You can go forage, that will decrease your attrition. This game's really all about attrition. So anyways, and then along with your command, your orders card, you can then sometimes play a card for its event. So for example, here the 11th Corps arrives. So play along with your ops card. If it's September or later, you get some extra reinforcements. There's a whole ton of these. Some of these cards are going to be better for the event at different times, very situational. But because you're always playing a card every turn for orders, all cards are always useful. You're never going to have as many cards as you want. And you're never going to have the right cards you need at the right time. So it's really, really important how you manage your cards, what you hang on to, and so forth. There are some cards that are removed from game once they've been used. So Poniatowski, for example, the 9th Corps showing up. There's a bunch of different events. Here's the Treaty of Bucharest. We did get Chichikov into the campaign pretty late for the Russians. So after you do that, you're going to place your orders on the map. And so you're going to put assign order blocks facing you to each of your commanders. And the opponent's going to do that as well. So eventually you're going to have a board with a bunch of blocks on it. It might look something like, you know, you might say, I want him to march, or I might want him to place a depot, something like that, right? So you're going to be able to see what orders you're giving, but you won't be able to see your opponents. And then very similar to Game of Thrones with the order system, you're going to resolve the orders in a very specific sequence. So first, force marches. And the player that has the initiative, it starts with the French, but can change over the course of the game. They're going to get to execute one of their force march orders in this sort of force march sequence. And they can choose whether they go first or they let their opponent go first. And alternating, one at a time, back and forth, each side's going to execute their force march orders that they want to do. Then you're going to go to the cavalry patrol. So force march lets you move twice. Cavalry patrols lets you scout an area adjacent to you if you have cavalry to see what's in their stack. Then you're going to march. This is a shorter march. You can move one space instead of two. Then there's evade. So if you move into an enemy space, there's going to be a battle. This is where the evade command lets you avoid battle. The other thing that's important about evade is it puts down a devastation marker in the space you're avoiding from. So one of the key things for the Russians in this game is they want to be avoiding really early. They are outclassed and outnumbered by the French to a significant degree. The French are going to want to be hyper-aggressive. They're going to want to attack the Russians. And as we historically know, the Russians pulled back pretty aggressively for a long period over the summer. Every time you do that, you raise the devastation level in the spaces that you're evading from. These devastation markers add to the stack size of the columns that are on them. So for example, if we take a look here at Murat, Murat is here standing on a one. So if Murat had three units under him, when it comes time to measure attrition, Murat actually has four units under him. These can go as high as three, and there's an attrition table where every turn, based on a weather roll, here, you're going to get potentially more modifiers. It's obviously worse in the winter. You're going to have to check all of your stacks on the board and then see how big the modified size is, which is the weather die roll plus if there's any devastation plus the size of the stack, and how far away from a supply depot, which are these cubes, that stack is. And then you're potentially going to take exhaustion hits, plus you're going to increase the devastation again. So what starts as a very clean map winds up at the end of the game looking like this. You can see basically the route that the French took through Russia to try and get to Moscow. French came in this way pretty aggressively, swung through here. The Russians were evading. I was the Russians, by the way. You can see some of these spots, three. Once we got to Vitebsk, the Russians were making it extremely difficult. They were evading a lot. They were trying to stay in areas turn to turn, so that when we had to do the attrition, they were increasing the devastation as much as possible, so that when the French had to go through there, they're going to be taking massive attrition hits. It's a really great system. It really feels, it captures the spirit of the campaign. I really, really like the way that big armies can't sit in one spot forever and put up a giant wall. The Russians, yes, they can consolidate their forces and make a huge army, which we did in Smolensk, and I'll get to that. But, you know, you stay there too long and suddenly you're the one taking the attrition hits. You basically eat out the entirety of the surrounding area, and then you've got to move on. So even though, you know, you might lose a battle, you still might force the defender to have to leave. So, so getting back to the orders that we were talking about here. So evade, then you would execute any battles. Battles are pretty simple. You just count up your strength points based on the units you have, which is here, plus a die roll that you take, that you make. And the dice are custom dice, and they're different for both sides. So here's the Russian die. It hits, it does sometimes adds one, two, three. Sometimes you can roll minus two. This would be like a huge snafu. And then you've also got one if you're defending as the Russians, right? But if you're attacking, that would be zero. Russians don't want to be attacking too much. Here's the French die. They can go anywhere between negative one and three, but then there's two special sides. In summer, they'll get four, but if this rolls in winter, it's zero. And if you roll this in winter, you get minus one, but it's zero in summer. So, the French are basically on a clock, as they were historically, and then you just compare the number of hits, and then based on the number of hits, you're going to take, losses or exhaustion steps. There might be some cavalry pursuit, depending on who has more cavalry points. You might earn victory points if you eliminate a specific number of units, and you might shift the initiative depending on how well the battle goes for you. And then, so after the battles, then you're going to get to do things like rally. So if you had any rally orders down, units under the rally will get to flip back over to full strength. There might be Cossack raids. The Russians are the only ones I think that can do this, and this allows the Russians to, if they're adjacent to a French army with exhausted units, they can eliminate a French unit that's exhausted. That's important at the end of the game because the Russians are going to get bonus points for the number of French they managed to put in the casualties box here. All Russian casualties are just put in the force pool and they can come back via reinforcements. All French casualties go here in this casualty box, and then for every three casualties at the end of the game, the Russians are going to score a victory point. So, trying to make it as difficult as possible for the French on this march across Russia as it was historically done. And so as the French, on that note, as the French, you're trying to basically exceed what Napoleon was able to do and do it with less losses in better time, essentially, is what the challenge is for the French. And then finally, there's the attrition step, then you can place depots, right, if you want to build depots, which is really important for your supply lines. The Russians aren't building a lot of depots early in the game. They've got a lot of depots spread along the country, and they're going to get taken over as the French advance. Critically, when you lose a depot, you lose a card from your hand. So frequently the Russians are playing with an empty hand for a lot of the game. It's very painful because cards drive all of your actions. But the French have to construct depots as they go. And if they outrun their supply, they're going to take more attrition. And so there's this careful balance that the French have to achieve by moving forward driving the Russians back, trying to get to some clear spaces where they can maintain the army force, but also have forces building depots in their rear. And depots need to connect via four movement points all the way back to the sort of eastern part of the empire. And that's very critical. And that played a huge role at the end of our game as well. We'll talk about what happened there. And then finally, you determine line of communications if you have those depots. And then you go on and you do it. Do another turn. Each month is five turns. There's a special turn at the beginning of each month where you get a new cards and you get some reinforcements. So in general, that's the game. There's a lot of bluffing. It's very, very smart. The how you use your orders, the order that you sequence what you're trying to do with your orders based on your positioning, the way you try and set up for future turns so that your orders will help you achieve the objectives you have for yourself. It is just so crunchy, and it's not difficult to play. The rules are very easy to understand. They're written very well. The game, once you get the hang of it, plays super fast, but there's a lot of agonizing decisions. We were sitting here across the table from each other the whole game, just groaning, being like, why does everything suck? Why does everything suck? Because if you're the French player, you start out with this massive army, you know, behind your screens. You've got all these armies. Here's where we ended. Here's Napoleon. Napoleon's got the French guard, a bunch of infantry, some cavalry here. Here's Murat. Murat has one exhausted infantry unit. What else we got? Here's Eugene, who's under Napoleon right now. Here's Jerome, who actually, in this game, didn't go home. He's got some, what is these? Are these Prussians or Austrians? He's got some Austrians under him, plus some infantry. Just full of agonizing decisions. For the French, everything you do is making you lose units. You have this giant army, so whether even if you win a battle, you might take some losses, you might not, but then when it comes time for attrition, you've got to take your attrition losses, and you just see this slow bleed of your forces behind your screens. And of course, the Russian player doesn't know what you're bleeding away or where they're bleeding from, really, but it just hurts. It's painful. And by the time you reach, you know, the approach to Moscow, you're scrabbling together as much as you can. In this game, it was, you know, the Napoleon, I don't think Napoleon won a single battle. He may have won one early, but this game was defined by Napoleon failing to win battles that were really close and the Russians somehow coming up huge. As the Russians, you have almost nothing on the board and you are just desperately hoping that the French don't make a lunge at you before you can execute a force march order, or you are desperately hoping that, you know, the evade order that you have there isn't canceled by a card or whatever, and you're just trying to make it as difficult as possible. Typically, you don't want to engage at all. So in our game, what ended up happening was we had the French moving through here. They took Vilna pretty easily. The Russians abandoned Vilna pretty early. And my strategy as the Russians coming into this game, because I had played sort of the first 2 months a couple weeks ago to get a sense of what it was like to play the game, to learn the game. And the sense I got from there is that the Russians have to give ground aggressively and almost every turn, at least through the main thrust of the French advance. I was a little too quick to give the flanks away on the first time we played. So in this game, I wanted to secure those flanks and just keep them up here. I wanted to keep the Baltics as much as possible, and I wanted to keep Ukraine and Moldavia as much as possible, and force the French to have to commit defenses to their flanks, commit resources to preventing me from doing an end around and eliminating depots in the French rear. And I think it worked really, really well. The French committed Jerome and Schwarzenberg here to keep Tormasov from making raids into their southwestern rear. I kept waiting for Jerome to leave. There is a card in the French deck that forces Jerome out of the game, but that never popped up. It did in our first game, but in this one it didn't. So I wasn't able to do too much with Tormasov, but I did get the Romanians under Chichagov into the game kind of late, and that provided some extra manpower down here to keep the French honest on their southern flank. In the north, Wittgenstein, I did early try and come down from Riga, but as I was making that move, the French got reinforced by Davout, who came onto the map, and Davout came on with a much bigger force than Wittgenstein could hope to take away. So my plan of being able to sort of like let the French push into the middle to their detriment to then get encircled from behind didn't quite work out, but it did force the French to commit a lot of forces into defending those flanks while the main offensive was happening. So as we moved through the game, the summer was moving along. The French didn't have too much trouble in Vilna. They didn't have too much trouble in Minsk. I actually evacuated Minsk and let the French take it because the attrition was the devastation there was pretty high. And then things changed once we crossed the Berezina River. So this is where the French started to slow down a little bit. We had a big battle. I believe it was at Mogilev. I believe there was a big battle, or it might have been here. Actually, I think it was here. It was in Borisov. I had a huge Russian army assembled there. I had a really good card. I had Constantine's Corps card in my hand. basically all I had to do, and Napoleon advanced, I basically had the advantage, and all I needed to do was for the French not to roll this. And the French rolled that, and they beat me, and they caused a huge amount of losses to the Russians. I mean, the French took their share of losses as well, but it was a bloody, bloody battle that the Russians could not afford to have lost, and they did lose it. And I was forced into a scrambling regroup. At that point, the French had kind of split the army, so we had Bagration and Platov down on this side of the board, and we had Kutuzov up here, and the French were about to strike and split those two. So I frantically tried to retreat and consolidate my lines, and then I decided, okay, the next best avenue of defense for the Russians was going to be Smolensk. The French were advancing, and you can tell by the board here the way these highways, so we've got two connections, we've got highways and we've got roads or trails. You need to keep the highways open. The highways are what, when you check attrition, these only count as one distance, versus the trails or the roads count as two distance. And you can see this locust network of the roads here at Smolensk. Smolensk is the key to getting to Moscow. So I said, okay, if I can recuperate the army now that Kutuzov was in the game, and Bagration, who's a really good defensive general, was able, even though he lost the battle, he was able to survive sort of the French advance. I think I had a casualty. I think I had a general casualty. I think it was, Barclay. Barclay died in the battle of near Mogilev of right here. So I was out of generals. I was frantically trying to get my army together. And then I made a stand at Smolensk with Bagration. The French came in. They had surrounded Smolensk basically on the southwest. They made an assault. The Russians ended up winning the battle very narrowly. That put a huge wrench into the French advance, and it for the first time really slowed them down on this campaign, losing that battle of Smolensk. That bought me some time to regroup. I was able to bring forces out of Moscow and down south here from Voronezh to join under Kutuzov. Up in here in this area. The French then also regrouped and made another attack on Smolensk, which Bagration then was able to successfully defend again, and that was two losses for Napoleon. So that was two victory points for the Russians for winning battles against Napoleon, and the French just were not able to crack Smolensk. However, by that time, Smolensk was now up to a 3 devastation level, and I had to get out of there because Bagration's army was massive. It was eating out all of the food, and I didn't want to take any more losses. I was trying to preserve Russian manpower at that point, so we ended up pulling back. Kutuzov and Bagration joined forces near northeast of Orsha. The French were able to continue their advance. And then finally, and by the way, at this point, having lost two battles in Smolensk, we were in October, so we were in the winter. That's when the winter cards came in. A lot of the French cards in the winter, French winter deck, are really punitive against them. A lot of the winter cards are just generally make attrition extremely gnarly. And this is where we ended. So we played through October, and we called the game at the beginning of November. Napoleon, at this point, very behind schedule. He made him and Murat and Eugene were in this general area trying to take Moscow. They ended up taking Kaluga at great cost to the devastation there, so they had to move on. They couldn't sort of stick around. They were at the end of their depot network, stretching all the way out here, and they were just never able to pin down Bagration or Kutuzov into sort of a decisive battle. Napoleon, finally, on the last turn, was able to move here to Mozhaisk, and Kutuzov avoided, and the last of the Russian army is here in Moscow at this point, but Moscow is basically almost fully devastated, and it was going to come down to one big battle. Unfortunately, Napoleon, not a lot of units left. I think the strength of the Russian army was 21. Napoleon's working here with 7, 8, 9, 13, basically, with the unit strength. You can see that the French Guard really took it on the chin. The Battle of Smolensk was very devastating to the French Guard. They were thrown back by Bagration, and so the French were just not able to get their forces, rehabilitated in such a way that they could attack Moscow. The other thing that the Russians did on this final in October, as the winter started, was they squirted out a little Cossack unit here from Gzatsk. And there was a depot in Vitebsk, and that Cossack unit was able to force march his way over a couple turns and eliminate the depot in Vitebsk, which cut the French line of communication of depots. And on this turn in November, there was no French units able to rebuild that depot. They were going to be on the full maximum out of supply column. That was just going to evaporate the army. And the Russians already were scoring 6 points from casualties up to that point. And the French still hadn't gotten to positive VPs. The Russians start with 14. The French had whittled it down. But if you add another 6 Russian VPs, we're up to 9. Moscow is only worth 5. So the French conceded with Napoleon's army at the gates, but unable to take the city, and with his entire army about to melt away to hunger and cold. So that is where we ended. It was an extremely epic experience. It felt so tense the whole time. The game does an amazing job of feeling tense, of feeling like you never have enough to do. You always want just like one or two more orders every turn, one or two more orders, and you just can never get them. So you have to really prioritize what you're doing at any given spot. And one of the things I should also mention here is that because the Russians took so many losses to their leaders, they were able to more efficiently use their orders because they only had a few columns that really needed those orders. So as the French got further into Russian territory and the Russian army started to shrink, the orders were more impactful for the Russians, whereas the French still had to get their, still had to spread their orders around a lot of the time. And while the French deck does have a higher card value for orders, you know, you started to see that over time, that the offensive stalling out in Smolensk, all that time taken to take that city and then the retreat back to Moscow, the French just could never find the momentum that they had. And the Russian orders were more impactful to the overall campaign. This is a phenomenal game. I think if you have any interest in the campaign, the Moscow campaign of 1812, of the Napoleonic era in general, I'll show you the final positions here. We had Kutuzov and Bagraton, Napoleon, Murat, Eugene's in there somewhere, and then here's Davout, keeping an eye on Wittgenstein. Here's Jerome, who never went home. Here's Schwarzenberg, and here is Tormasov and Chichikov. So if you have any interest in the campaign, highly recommend this game. It captures the operational challenges for both sides so well. It is a struggle, no matter what side you're playing, a struggle to play and keep the opponent at bay. It always feels like you're one turn away from a major victory or one turn away from complete collapse. And that shifts as you go. So the Russians feel at the start of the game, they're one turn away from complete collapse. And the French feel like victory is one step ahead. And as you go through the game and start to reach sort of the extension of the French advance, it goes the other way. The French are like, oh my God, attrition is terrible. I've lost so much manpower. I'm one step away from complete collapse. And the Russians are like, I'm one battle away from crushing the French defeat so that they can't get to Moscow. It's just a phenomenal, it plays very well. The system is very intelligently designed. If you like games like Levy and Campaign, a lot of those same challenges are found here, just done very differently. If you like The Fog of War, I think The Fog of War here is done really, really well. It makes for unexpected moments while still meaning that you're afraid to fully commit. Because you don't have perfect knowledge, the French steamroller is not as fully efficient as it would be if you had perfect knowledge of what's going on. And as the Russians, you know, because you don't have perfect knowledge of what the French are doing, you have to play conservatively. You can't be really aggressive, and you have to pick your spots. And so each side is just agonizing over every move, every order you place, every card you play, every move that you're making with your units, you know, all of that stuff goes into a really tight, tense experience. After we were done, we both were like, we're exhausted. We both need to lay down and have a nap with how stressful that was. But it was a ton of fun as well. So I will bring this video to a close. That was the after action report of the full campaign. It was a Russian victory at the beginning of November as Napoleon retreats back to the palace in Paris to lick his wounds. If you haven't checked out 1812, Napoleon's Fateful March from Vukha yet, get on this. This is going to go down as a classic, I believe. The designer is already working on a new game in this system that's going to capture the 1813 campaign, which comes right after this, which I think will also be fascinating for different reasons. And I think me and my opponent are both very excited for that because it's going to provide different challenges for both sides, whereas this is very much a war of attrition. That one will be a war of maneuver. High marks for this. Expect to see this on my list at the end of the year. I have enjoyed every moment I have spent playing this game so far this year, of two games now. There's not a dull moment in this title, and the designer should be commended for what he's achieved here. This may be, I haven't played all of them, I want to play more, but this may be the definitive game on this particular topic, with the way that it just unfolds as on your tabletop. So definitely check it out, high marks, and hopefully I'll get a chance to play it again soon.